Let's look at how to cook beans. The soaking, the cooking methods, what does the science say is the best way to get the most benefit out of these nutrition powerhouses? First, should we soak or not? Most people soak so beans will cook faster. But there are other benefits. Beans contain some great nutrients, but they also contain some stuff we want to reduce, like the famous lectins. Yeah, you often get that reaction nowadays when you mention the L word. We'll come back to why they're not a big deal. You may also have heard of something called phytates. Now, phytates sounds like something out of a boxing match, but it's actually a kind of nutrient package. If you go on a hike, you might pack some food for later. Beans do exactly the same. Beans are seeds at the end of the day, so they store nutrients for later when they sprout and need those nutrients to grow. And the way they store them are phytates. That's all fine and dandy. Only problem is, phytates bind strongly to calcium, iron, zinc, etc., making it really hard for us to absorb those minerals. Soaking breaks down the phytates and frees up those nutrients for us to absorb. Okay, how long should we soak? As we all know, beans swell in water. After 16 hours, they're saturated, they're done absorbing water, so usually overnight, one day is a solid ballpark. Believe it or not, teams of scientists have actually sat there and measured what happens to beans if they soak for one day, 2 days, 3 days. Your tax dollars hard at work. So phytates actually keep dropping up to 3 days, so if you want to soak longer, 2 or 3 days, you can. Otherwise, 1 day is a solid soak. Another great option is to sprout. All you do is drain the soaking water and leave the beans sitting in a jar or bowl and rinse once a day. That's it. 4 to 6 days total seems to be ideal. Sprouting gets rid of the most phytates, and it also makes the nutrients in beans more absorbable. It also increases the antioxidant power of beans, peas, chickpeas, etc. The exception are lentils, which actually seem to lose antioxidant power with sprouting. So if you want to sprout your beans, go for it. If not, if you don't have the time, just give them a good soak. Still a great food. I always wondered why the water changes color when you soak beans. With black beans, it gets dark. With chickpeas, it gets kind of yellowish. Yeah, because that's the type of thing that keeps me up at night. It turns out the coloring is exactly because there are soluble constituents of the beans that are leaching out into the water, which is why before cooking, the bean experts recommend discarding the soaking water. Switching to fresh water gets rid of the phytates that leached out during soaking. Also, beans are notorious for causing gas. Some people even avoid them altogether because of that. That's called by some oligosaccharides, some small natural sugars in beans. Turns out those also leach out during soaking, so discarding the soaking water helps get rid of them as well. So adding that step may help us get the best of beans without the worst. Also, if you're not used to eating beans, just start slow, small amounts, and then slowly build it up. That allows your gut bugs, your microbiome, to slowly grow. It's just like building muscle at the gym. Okay, cooking. Cooking also helps reduce the phytates and the lectins. Okay, let's deal with this real quick. There are several reasons why we shouldn't be scared of of these. First, they're highly thermolabile, which means they're destroyed by cooking. It's been repeatedly shown that after 10 minutes at boiling temperature, lectin activity is reduced to zero. Second, lectins have also been tied to some potential benefits, including anti-cancer activity. The point is not that we should go buy lectin supplements or stuff our face with purified lectins. The point is, these things are rarely black and white, good and bad. It's usually a matter of amount and context. So even foods we don't necessarily cook, like tomatoes, are not suddenly overnight made unhealthy because they contain lectins. That doesn't make any nutritional sense. We know if a food is health-promoting or disease-promoting from direct tests of that food, not from speculating about an individual component in a vacuum. Now, of course, this goes both ways. Sometimes people want to argue eggs are bad or olive oil is bad strictly on the basis of a component. The food industry also loves this logic. Some ultra-processed, artificial food is suddenly good because it contains vitamins. That's not a strong argument. Has the food itself been shown to promote health or disease? That's the bottom line. The rest is misdirection. Legumes are consistently tied to beneficial outcomes, whether it's in controlled scientific experiments where they're swapped with other foods or observations of long-lived populations. Across the board, they come out as huge winners. Finding a new molecule doesn't change anything. The direct test of that food already accounted for all the components. We already know the net effect of legumes is massively positive, regardless of what each individual molecule is doing. So we don't need to be scared of lectins anymore. Okay, cool. That worked. Okay, how should we cook beans? Some studies suggest steaming over boiling because it seems to retain more antioxidant activity. They also mention pressure steaming, using a steaming basket inside the pressure cooker. But if you don't have that apparatus, regular steaming or pressure cooking generally looks a little bit better than regular boiling. Again, lentils are the odd man out. Regular old boiling seems to work best for them. Quick parenthesis, the point of all this information is not to make us OCD. Peace of mind is also huge for health. In this house, we have a pressure cooker, so we use it. But when I'm traveling or I'm somewhere else, I use whatever I have. Regular pan, whatever. Unless you do something really weird like eat raw beans, they're a great food no matter how you cook them. People have been eating them for eons and enjoying their benefits without reading 1,000 studies on how to cook beans, so please don't stress over this. All that said, since my fellow nerds sat there and watched chickpeas boil for a living, and we have all this information at our fingertips, and this fellow nerd went through all the studies, why not be aware of the information and get that extra benefit if it's not any extra work? How long you cook your beans depends on your equipment and your method of cooking, of course. You want them soft enough to squish with a fork or between your fingers. Ballpark, an hour, give or take, if you're boiling or steaming. If you're boiling in the pressure cooker, 10 to 15 minutes is usually enough. Okay, what do we do with the cooking water? Some of the bean components leach into the cooking water, just like during soaking. That goes for those oligosaccharides that can cause some gas, and it also goes for the minerals like calcium, iron, and zinc. So here you have a choice, because it depends from person to person. If gas is a problem for you, you can discard the cooking water and minimize those oligosaccharides. Otherwise, you can consume the cooking water if you want and get those extra minerals, in a soup, for example. If you can eat beans like a champ and no gas crisis, you can do that. Or if you're upset at your family and you want to punish them, learn all kinds of tips with these videos. One last tip for iron. The iron in beans is non-heme, and you can boost the absorption by having it with a source of vitamin C, like red bell peppers, or with some onions or garlic, or with a source of beta carotene. All of those boost your absorption of non-heme iron. Need more ideas for plant protein? Here's my top 7. And here's some more on iron, how to maximize absorption and get all the iron you need. I'll see you next week.